Thank you. Good evening and welcome to the Board of Selectmen meeting for Tuesday, October 4th at 7 p.m. My name is Scott Bugby. To my left is Jim Lehan. To his left is our Town Administrator, Jack Hathaway. And to Jack's left is our Executive Assistant, Marion Harrington. Our colleague, Jeff Palumbo, is away tonight, so will not be joining us. I also want to advise folks in the audience this meeting is audio and videotaped. And if we could now stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America, to which the Republic, which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Jack, I gotta get a cue card. Jack, can you read us the agenda, please?
Happy to. 7 p.m., we have a public hearing for a liquor license for craft beer cellar of Norfolk, 17 Pine Street, Unit 4. 7:15, we have a dangerous dog hearing, 48 Noon Hill Avenue, followed by the town administrator report, including a review of the fall special town meeting warrant articles.
Oh, thank you very much, Jack. Can I get a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Would you be kind enough to read the public hearing notice?
I will, sir. Notice is hereby given under the provisions of Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 138. A public hearing will be held on October 4th, 2016 at 7 p.m. on application submitted by Better Than Soup, Inc., DBA Craft Beer Cellar Norfolk, licensee Andrew G. Lippitt, manager. The applicant seeks a wine and malt beverage license not to be consumed on the premise for 17 Pine Street, Unit 4, Norfolk, Mass. This hearing will be held in Room 124, Town Hall, 1 Liberty Lane, Norfolk, Mass. So say the Board of Selectmen.
Great, thank you. Andrew, would you like to join us up here? Please.
Where would you like me?
Anywhere you feel comfortable.
All right.
Excellent.
It's called pick a seat.
Yeah. We got plenty of openings tonight.
Pick this one.
We appreciate it. Can you just tell us a little bit about what you're going to be doing? And
sure. Craft Beer Cellar is a franchise that specializes in specialty beer and pretty much only specialty beer. I like to tell people, if they want to know what our store is about, to kind of picture a fancy wine shop where you can go in and have tastings, you can get an educational class about how the wine is made, you can find people from the vineyard who are going to tell you about how they make their wine. So picture that, and then throw away all the wine and put in fancy beer, okay. And that's pretty much what Craft Beer Cellar is all about. We're all about great beer, hospitality, and education.
Okay. So you'll be having tastings there then, too, either?
Yeah, we hope to do that a couple of times a week, of course, conforming with all Massachusetts laws, 2-ounce pours and
okay,
no more.
Okay.
It is, in fact. Okay. And we hope to be doing things like that, perhaps other sort of educational classes, too, about how beer is made, bring in brewers to speak about their craft, that sort of thing.
Okay. And how many franchisees locations are there?
I will be the 13th or 14th in Massachusetts, and there's another dozen across the country. Most recently, they just opened one in a national park in Hot Springs, Arkansas.
Nice. Okay. Where's the closest one then to this location?
I guess the closest one to here would be Framingham, okay. Right out on Route 9. Awesome. Nice bunch of guys there. Should go and visit them.
Okay. And are you tip certified? Will all employees be tip certified?
All the employees will be tips or a similar certification. They'll also all have certification from an organization called Cicerone, which is a worldwide body that makes sure that people are educated about the beer. That's one thing that's going to differentiate us from other places that sell beer, is that you'll be able to talk to anybody in there and get a good recommendation, get a good pairing with food. People really know their stuff in there.
Well, Mr. Bugby's taken all the questions that I was going to ask, so we're good. So I'll just ask one creative one. Who came up with this name, Better Than Soup?
I was going to ask that.
I'm afraid that's me, and it refers to the fact that my last position was as a learning and development person at a soup factory. It was not my favorite job.
Say no more.
Yeah. And objectively, let's face it, beer is better than soup.
It's a great name. I was just curious how you ever came
of
up
course,
with that.
Of course, we'll be doing business as Craft Beer Cellar Norfolk.
Got it. Okay. And sorry.
Well, Mr. Hathaway has threatened us with physical harm if we didn't approve this.
I look forward to
He's very excited.
Well, I got to tell you, not only Mr. Hathaway, but also Marion, everybody in Town Hall in Norfolk has just been terrific.
I don't know if that's a good thing or bad thing.
No.
Oh, terrific. I thought you meant they wanted your beer. I thought they wanted your beer. Okay.
No, no, no. They've been terrific in leading me through this process, which is a little daunting. Yeah, if you're not some sort of a legal professional. And they've been just great. So I'm really
nice
feeling welcome in the town, and I
that's
thank
nice
you for
hear.
That.
Thank you for that.
We need new businesses in town. Can you just give us, I don't know, Marion wanted me to ask, the hours, days and hours you've been open? It might be on the application, but I just
yeah, I think I'll probably, for the most part, be mirroring the hours of the pizza restaurant that's next door. They open at 11 on weekdays and close at 9. I figure I'll open a little bit earlier than that on Saturday, perhaps a 10 a.m. opening with a 9 p.m. closing. And I think the standard hours on a Sunday would probably be 12 to 6, except when there's an event down at Gillette Stadium, perhaps. I'd want to open a little bit earlier than that to get the tailgater business.
You can do 10 a.m. on Sunday. There
you go. Is that something that I have to notify the town ahead of time if I'm going to do it early 1 week?
It should be on the license.
Yeah, I would suggest you designate the hours of operation on the license to whatever it is you want. You can always choose to open later, but you can't open
it. Yeah, you can make it shorter.
So
in that case, 10 a.m. it is.
Designate the best deal you want. No, I don't have any other questions.
Questions from the audience? Comments?
How's your construction?
It's
okay, it's still in process.
It's in a waiting game, yes. Yeah, I'm still working with contractors and scheduling. It's a busy time of year for them, but I hope to start very, very soon getting that up and running. It's kind of an empty shell now, but if all goes well, we could still see a November opening.
And this
so
is
your
the
target
far
date's November?
Right.
It's a target. I'm not 100% sure it's a realistic target, but it is, in fact, a target.
Good luck.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Can I get a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second. Any other comments, questions? Well, hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Congratulations.
Welcome to Norfolk.
Thank you very much. I feel welcome already.
Great.
Oh, good. Well, can I get a
thank you, gentlemen and ladies.
So moved.
Second. Any other comments, questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Public hearing is closed. Thank you. Good
thanks
luck.
Very much.
Good luck. Welcome to the town.
We are a little ahead of schedule.
Tight ship here, Jack.
So yeah, you know, that's what I like about the Bugbee chairmanship. We're always moving fast. so you want to talk a little bit about the public safety building for
why
5
not?
Minutes?
Yeah, we got.
We can 6 minutes. Can start. That won't be long enough.
Yeah. What do you think? Yeah.
Go ahead.
We had a meeting today at the public safety building, the police station, I should say, and the regional dispatch center. Trying to iron out some. Disagreements. You know, we've asked some questions of the architect. Project manager has been very good bringing the town's point of view, I think, to the front of the discussion. We're a little, you know, and Jim is the Jim certainly has brought been bringing the matter up of the schedule up regularly, and I agree with him. You know, we've fallen behind. And there's a little bit of finger pointing going around as to why. I don't think I don't think anybody, you know, I think the architect really has fallen behind. And we were a little concerned about that because he signed a $50 million deal at the same time he signed our $14 million deal. So we're going to try and prod him along. We're still trying to get 100% design documents done by the end of October, which will be aggressive in order to be able to do that. But that's what he's committing to doing. In order to do that, we need to get some 75 to 90% documents done before that we can review, and then he can go and create his bid-ready documents, which are the 100%. We've made some decisions to cut some costs, which were good, particularly the generator. We're having a lot of discussion right now about the outer envelope of the building. For two reasons, one being insulation, making sure that we've got the right insulation 100% around the building, and what the cost of that is. You know, we're balancing the installation cost versus the long-term energy costs. And then the other thing we're looking at is aesthetics. There's an aesthetic consideration too, because we're going to have to make some changes to that outer material, and it's the caramel color versus the more traditional police, you know, gray, battle station gray color that would be more appropriate. So, you know, by no stretch of the imagination, we're trying to throw money away on aesthetics, but we also don't want to half gray, half caramel candy color building. So that's the short and sweet from my point of view. There's
maybe just add a couple of things to it. Part of the complication is that this really involves three projects. It involves the police, it involves the regional dispatch, and it involves the fire. So we have one number to deal with, and we're trying to balance the appropriateness of those two numbers to each of these projects and be sure that one doesn't sort of cheat on the other. And then there's the issue of what is shared or non-shared expenses associated with the regional dispatch. So you've got three governing bodies all working around one singular project. Good news is we have the same architect for all three projects, but the bad news is that we're having difficulty, and this has really been my frustration, we're having difficulty getting definitive financials around this project because of the ambiguity on what is or is not covered under REC. And which reminds me, I got a call from Nutty, and he wants us to get together with him next week. I forgot to mention that today. So it's been frustrating in that regard. We were supposed to go out to bid in August, and here we are in October, and we're not out to bid yet. There are codes that change January 1. We asked the project manager to make sure, and I'm sure he has, because he knows the codes are changing too, that the specs all reflect the new codes and not the old codes, because we don't want to get into change considerations. Change considerations cost us a whole lot more than if it's in the original specs. So, but it's a diligent group. We're, I don't want to say beating them up a little bit, but we're firm in wanting to get this within budget. And we will. It's just taking longer than I'd hoped. Okay. That's all. But we'll get there.
Is it getting closer to resolving the shared things, or is that a kind of
I would say. I mean, there's still some open issues. Jack and I need to go negotiate the lease with the other towns. That's the call that Nutty made to me the other day. So there's still things, but that doesn't have anything to do with the construction.
Right. I was going to say, no, that part is like elevator.
I think the guidelines are pretty well entrenched now as to how we're going to go forward in terms of the division of labor and costs. One of the big issues was the generator, which we resolved today favorably, actually, probably save us $100,000 to do it the way we ended up deciding to do it today. But there are specific guidelines. An example, we talked about having this generator be gas versus diesel. Some logical reasons why, and we have gas down there. You can't use public gas lines for generators in public safety buildings. They have to be proprietary. They have to be on-site and totally self-contained. Okay. You can't be dependent on an outside source.
I guess I can see that.
So there's that kind of stuff gets in the way.
Okay.
But we'll work through it. We're getting there.
Okay, well, it's now 7:15. Trying to keep on schedule. Yep. Hillary, Warren, you guys want to join us up here?
We are getting to the point where we're probably going to be meeting every other week.
As opposed to what is it?
We've been meeting maybe once a month now. We're down to about every other week now, I think.
I wonder about it. I'm going to push it once a week when I get charged. It's your time,
good for
not
you.
My time.
Okay. Hillary, how are you? Officer, good to
how
see
you.
It's
Officer Vinson. First order of business is I think everybody needs to be sworn in.
No, I think we got Carol to do that. Is that what Carol's here for?
I have no idea what Carol is here for.
I have no idea.
In the past, it's been Jack or Marion.
Oh. You'll promise to do the truth, tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing about the truth?
I do.
Well, let me do it officially.
Let's do it officially. Yeah.
So, do you promise to tell the whole truth?
Yes.
What's that?
Okay.
You promise to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
I do.
You do?
So I wrote a condensed version because the police reports are very long. On 6/4 of 2013, I received a phone call from a resident stating he wanted to make me aware that on April 11th, 2013, he was walking his dog leashed upon a public way where Gary Sheehan's dog, Buddy, came off of his property and attacked his dog, causing injuries to his dog's head. His dog was treated for the injuries at their veterinarian. The dog owner stated he dealt with Sheehan directly, and Sheehan had told him he would pay for the veterinary bills and agree to have obedience training for his dog. On 8/11/2013, I was dispatched. I was advised by dispatch that a resident reported his dog had been attacked by Mr. Sheehan's dog while he was walking his dog leashed upon a public way. He stated that while he was walking by 48 Noon Hill, he saw Buddy tied to a bumper of a vehicle in a driveway. Buddy ran so hard towards the street that he broke the tie and proceeded to come out in the street where Buddy attacked his golden retriever. The reporter told me that he had to let go of his own dog and pull Buddy off of his dog. At one point, Buddy got free from him and went back and attacked his golden retriever again. Mr. Sheehan came running out, and he had to pin the dog to the ground to stop the attack. The reporter stated that his dog was bleeding profusely and that one of the injuries, Buddy had ripped off part of his dog's ear, and it had to be surgically reattached. On 2/11 of 2015, I received an email from ACO Cronin in Medfield that Buddy was involved in a third incident while in her town. ACO Cronin stated that in her email that she spoke with Sheehan and that he stated this was the first time his dog had ever done anything like this. She stated that this attack was between Buddy and another dog, which was leashed upon a public way. Mr. Sheehan was doing snow removal for a church in Medfield. Buddy was inside a vehicle with the window half open. The victim dog owner was walking her 25-pound cockapoo in front of Starbucks when she saw Buddy jump through the window. The dog owner stated Buddy did not back down at any point and promptly attacked her dog. Her dog was wearing a jacket, which she felt saved the life of the dog. Buddy then attacked the cockapoo's face in what the victim dog owner stated like a piece of meat. The dog owner stated she fell down as a result of the attack. Two men nearby shoveling came over and tried to remove Buddy from the cockapoo, but they were unsuccessful. It wasn't until Sheehan was there that the three men could break the fight up between Buddy and the cockapoo. The cockapoo prior to the attack only had vision in one eye due to glaucoma. Buddy injured the dog's other eye, and Tufts Veterinary Hospital had to sew the eye shut in an attempt to save the globe. Due to that incident, citations were issued. I issued a temporary restraining order, which the Board of Selectmen made permanently shortly thereafter. That order stated that Buddy could not be tied outside, he had to be walked on a leash, and if he was to leave the property, he would need to be leashed and muzzled. On 9/13/2016, I was dispatched by the police for a dog fight in progress on Day Street. I was informed that the dog that lived at 48 Noon Hill had broken free from his runner and attacked a dog being walked down Day Street on a leash. The dog that was attacked was already en route to the veterinarian for emergency care before my arrival. A resident of 48 Noon Hill was present, but Mr. Sheehan was not. She said she saw Buddy snap the cable and bolt out into the street, and then she heard screaming and ran back into the house for help. The dog fight was broken up by a neighbor who heard the victim dog's owner screaming in the street. The neighbor brought Buddy back to his house and placed him inside. Gary Sheehan showed up a short time later and we spoke regarding Buddy. I informed him that I will be in touch with the animal inspector to quarantine the dog again, and that if he doesn't consider euthanizing Buddy at the end of the quarantine period, I would be filing for a dangerous dog hearing. The resident from 48 Noon Hill also stated that she felt Buddy should be euthanized. This was witnessed by Detective Canadanian and Officer Vinson. During my investigation, I spoke to other witnesses who heard the victim dog owner screaming for help. She ran from her house to the scene. She noticed the victim dog's collar had been broken, was laying on the ground with fur and blood on it. She noticed that the dog was bleeding as well. She stayed on scene until the police arrived. I photographed the victim dog while he was being treated at Acorn. The dog had the through and through puncture on its ear, multiple neck and facial bites, and massive contusion, which is bruising around the throat. I asked the owner to come down to the station to fill out a statement the next day when she had settled down. The dog owner stated in her written report that her veterinarian stated the only reason her dog was alive is because of how thick his fur and skin was. I contacted other residents in my follow-up investigation. In speaking with one of the witnesses, I learned that there was a previous incident that was never reported to my department. She stated that she was taking care of a friend's dog at her house. She stated that she opened the car door to let the dog out on her property, and that Buddy ran towards that dog and attacked it in its head and neck. That fight was only broken up by Mr. Sheehan grabbing onto his dog. Since it was not made aware, I was not made aware of this incident until years later. The incident is relevant, but it is stale. I will not be taking actions. In that incident, Mr. Sheehan was bitten by the victim dog. And that's my story.
Officer, do you have anything that you can?
No, I have nothing to add. I was just there on the occasion on Day Street as a witness.
Well, your letter, Hillary, that you wrote in September states basically you're requesting the owner to euthanize the dog.
Correct.
Obviously, that hasn't happened.
No.
Or we wouldn't be here.
Correct.
So I'm assuming that's your recommendation.
That is my recommendation. You know, I'm not opposed, like the last hearing, if there was a way to put up a physical fence around the whole structure, the whole dwelling. It would have to be a solid physical fence to stop the stimulation visually for the dog. But again, it also falls back on the handling of this dog. If there's a fence, there might be a gate left open. There could be a door left open. We've seen that the restraining order was not adhered to in the past, so I have concerns about the handling. And also, in behavior of dogs, if they still get the stimulation but they can't see why they're stimulated, it could be scent, it could be they hear another dog going down the road. When that trigger goes off, he satiates that by biting. If he doesn't have that ability, he could redirect that behavior elsewhere, and that's also a concern I have.
When I looked at these pictures, I mean, I've had dogs my entire life, and what it appears that the dog managed to get the victim's on its back and go for the interior part of its throat, which is an attack mode for dogs.
Right, and they have escalated from bite to bite to bite.
I hate these. Want to see if Mr. Sheehan is here?
Mr. Sheehan, would you like to join us up here?
Yeah, we'll step down so they have room.
Thank you.
This is my son, Robert.
Hi. Robert Sheehan, how are you?
I actually adopted Buddy in Shelter, Rhode Island initially. He was about a year and a half old. So that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank
you.
So first of all, thank you for the opportunity to speak with you tonight. And essentially, our family has the same goal as the town here, which is to never let another incident with Buddy happen again, while also maintaining, like Hillary said, the right level of humanity for our dog, our family pet. We've had every incident that was laid out here in terms of Buddy escaping was preventable, in my opinion. We've contacted Colonial Fence in Norfolk, who came up with a proposal, as you can see, to secure the dog behind a pre-existing 6-foot-high fence along the length of our yard, which would eliminate some of that visual stimulation that triggers him to going into these fits. As you can see from the pictures, he's very, very good with people. There's never been an incident where he's even come close to attacking a person. He's in a nursing home comforting old people. But we also want to take complete responsibility for the fact that his ability to get off of the property has been our fault. And we think the comprehensive plan we've put together over the last couple of weeks would prevent that from ever happening again. It's not just a fence, it's training. I talked with a few different trainers. I found one in Boston that would come out to the property and work with him and other dogs. By the way, he lives with a chocolate lab now. There's no problems there. Other dogs that he knows in the neighborhood, there's no problems. It's strange dogs, a territorial trigger in front of her house where this happens. So the trainers think it's rectifiable, it's fixable. Obviously, we have to, number one, secure him so we can never get off the premises again and put anyone else's dogs at risk or make anyone feel unsafe in the neighborhood. We love Norfolk. I grew up here. My dad still lives here since the 80s. So we're on the same page there. It's just a matter of a means to an end. The fence is number one, secure him. Two, the training, which would be ongoing. I'll pay for that. And three would be anytime we're not at the house, we'll fortify the doors and windows, just, you know, and the town can come out and inspect that on whenever, and we'll adhere to anything that you guys think is reasonable. But 99.9% of the time, he's the sweetest dog in the world, never had a problem with a person. We love him, and we don't want to put him down.
Now, Rob, so would this fenced-in area have gates in it? As Hillary's concerned, you know, like, I know you don't, you know, I assume there's no young kids at home. I mean, gates can be left open by accident, and it's just...
We could work on, you know, some sort of, you know, it's like, I've talked to the guy at Colonial Fence. There's ways to secure the spring-loaded gates here.
It's money.
And it's also, it's not just a surface-level fence. We would do put it on cement, but we'd also put a barrier underneath the ground, so he's creative. It would prevent him from digging in the first place. He wouldn't even be able to dig out of this fence. It would be impossible for him to get out. But at the same time, it's not just locking him in a cage for his, you know, for the neighborhood. We're working with him behaviorally, medication. You know, they actually give Xanax to dogs. I read that in the last week.
We used it for our dog.
Okay.
Yeah. It's expensive.
Money's not really an object here because he is relatively young. We think he has at least a decade left of life. And like I said, we have a lot of good memories with him, and we want to have more. And I think that the plan here, if there's additions to make, we'll make them. If there's changes, we'll make them. But, you know, talk to the fence companies, the trainers, and we'll obviously talk to any neighbors that have concerns.
Jim?
Well, Hillary, can you join us again? Have you seen this?
No.
Oh, and the insurance policy. I got an insurance policy from Liberty Mutual. It's already paid for in place today.
Do you have any concerns that the dog could be at risk to a person or child?
No risk at all. And
I've been present at most of the incidents, and he had opportunity to hurt people, and he turned away. The time I got bit was the other dog.
Mm-hmm.
Went right through my head. Mm-hmm. And
like I said, I got him when he was a year and a half old, so I feel responsible for this. He was my dog. Then I had to move to the city for work. But he, you know, we don't know what happened into that, you know, before he was brought to that shelter. So I talked to, I didn't sugarcoat it when I talked to the trainers around the Boston area. I said these attacks are serious. We don't take them lightly. This isn't a joke to us. But they all agreed that it would, and it wasn't just a, hey, we want your business. It was, no, give me some other examples of dogs that have had issues. Even there was an example where a dog had killed another dog, but they were able to work with it. And again, number one, security. We're not going to ever trust him that no matter how much training is done, it wouldn't happen again. So we'll prevent that from being a possibility. But we also want to work with him and make sure he has a good life too.
And he does get along with dogs. And you know this, Hillary. Mm-hmm. We have a dog in the house. The neighbors have dogs. The dogs he knows, he never has issues with. It's this territorial thing. We don't really know. But hopefully this training thing, they actually come to your house. They train while they're at your house rather than take the dog out of his element into it, which I did before, and had him work with a trainer. But this new training program says it doesn't make sense not to do it in his own setting.
Right, they stage it, they would come around the corner with another dog with him in our control, and I mean, I wouldn't know if that would approve, but enough people are there.
So we have a plan, and we've worked at it. So just need to...
How old is Buddy now?
He's five, roughly five.
Well, I think he's actually closer to almost seven.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
He's always beyond
me.
He's
a rescue dog, so they weren't exactly sure of his age. We've had him for 6 years now.
Fall of 2011.
Right? So when we first got him, there weren't any incidents at all for a long time. And,
you got him in 2011, right? The first instance was 2013, so 2 years.
Well, one thing for sure, we can't have residents, folks, fearful for walking in front of your house with a dog that's on a leash to being attacked. We can't have that.
Yep.
I mean, these are significant wounds. Dogs do have disagreements. I have two dogs. They have disagreements. But
it was pretty bloodied up on this last one, too. So it was
the question is whose blood it was, though. I mean, you know.
Well, it was Buddy. He was all cut up.
But he initiated the attack.
Yeah.
Right.
Dogs will defend themselves.
Yeah. Sure.
And Goldens are not small dogs. So, Hillary, what's your opinion?
I would not approve of the chain link. It still does not block a visual barrier. The fencing that I know is pre-existing is pretty old, right?
Yeah, but we're not talking that. We're talking putting up a completely new enclosure.
Okay, so you wouldn't be using that fence line that's
just
there
to block the street.
Okay.
It would be separate from that, but we would fix that, the gate that is a little flimsy, and then that one actually is solid, so it does that. The fence is on the property now, it does block the vision.
It's got some light, though. You can't just block out all light.
No, it's 6.5 feet tall.
I'm not asking you to block out light. I'm asking the visual barrier for this dog to not get stimulated again.
So
I would still
just
go with a solid...
Facing the street, sign not the backyard. The backyard's all treed in, all evergreens.
Right, but it's for his behavior, to help him. This is about him.
Yeah.
Say you have a stray dog that goes shooting through your backyard. If he sees it through the chain link fence, he's going to get agitated. I think a solid structure fence for the enclosure is the way to go. I personally would like to see, like the last hearing, that it was a property fence. That way he can't get loose between going from the house to his enclosure, because we've seen it takes 2 to 3 people to pull this dog off.
One, just me, Hillary.
In the Medfield incident, there were 3 people.
Yeah, but when I came along, he was fine.
And during that transition from the house to the pen, what if he sees something and makes a bolt, dash, gets free, and this happens again? My only concern is the public safety of the people and their animals. So I would be totally fine with a solid structure fence.
I mean, I could go back to Colonial and talk to them about that, or we could do, he's a landscape construction business himself. We could figure that out.
I'd like to talk to a dog professional first to see what they say about
him. Bring him up.
Enclosing him in a space where he can't see anything. I don't know if that's good for the dog. It's like putting him in a dark area. But I know the strength of the fence that we're proposing here would hold a dog much bigger than Buddy. He's barely 90 pounds. And I know this, I've done this work with people in the past on these things. But I'm open to it, Hillary, if that's all you're going to do. But I disagree with you within that. I want to make sure the dog can stay mentally, you know.
Well, how big is the fence that you're proposing?
Well, it's 125 feet by 6 feet.
125 by 6?
Well, 6 feet high.
We can make it any size
we
really
want to.
But.
Actually, I don't understand the measurements either. We'd have to confirm that.
Because I wouldn't want a dog enclosed in a small area either.
You wouldn't do that.
But visually, I'm sure if you had the time to see the Kelly Boland presentation, the triggers, they've got to be managed, or we're not creating good quality of life for this animal. Another comment saying that this was territorial because it happens in front of the house. It also happened in Medfield. So I think there's different trigger than just property protection here. I think there's way deeper issues that need to be addressed. And what would the time frame be on the fence, and what kind of guarantees would we have in the meantime that this doesn't happen? These are the concerns.
So the guarantees are that we've had the dog for all these years, and we've gone through long stretches where there's been no problems. So we're on high alert right now at the moment.
We essentially treat until the fence is completed. We'd essentially act like there was a quarantine in place. If there is one or isn't, we would behave as such.
And the building of the construction would depend on the contractor. You know, we can get.
Well, they said they could move on it, you know, within a week.
Really? That's
yeah.
good. So we're investing money and time and effort here, and we think there's value in the dog. And I think if we do all these things, you know, with Hillary can come by and check, see how we're doing. I've talked to Chris Wider about this at length, and he agrees with me that, you know, we should go forward with a plan that works, and this is a plan that he feels works.
And the conversations I had with Colonial and the dog trainers happened after I talked to Chris, and I said, what would be the best? And he said, well, if you could come up with a behavioral course like this, and if you could have this type of fence, that would do it. That would do the trick. In his opinion, it's one person. But.
Now, what would you do, you know, after on this dog training if it wasn't able to decrease the triggers or work? I don't know mm-hmm. how you measure work, but I'm sure they're looking. You know, what's the recourse then?
Find another trainer. They're rated very highly. We don't have 100% certain of anything, but it seems like that's the best. They come out to the property where most of the incidents have happened, work with them one-on-one. And it's also, you know, that flat fee that you see in the quote there is actually, it's perpetual, however you want to phrase it. It's,
right.
you know, they keep doing it until the behavior is gone. So it's essentially until we agree that he's, behaving better, that they would continue to work with them. If we need to, we'll find additional, you know, trainers. There's a lot of different options.
Is this fence proposal go from each corner of your home? Is that how you intend to install it?
No, we have a very large backyard, so we always go out the back door through a porch. And
could you do me a favor? Could you maybe on this board with a marker just sort of outline your home and where you think the fence would go?
Yep.
You want to do it?
Yeah, sure.
Go for it.
So this is our house. This is our driveway. Garage. Backyard. This is a neighbor's property over here. And then right, so it's the end of the driveway up to the garage, and behind the garage we have a fence coming out to the edge of the neighbor's property.
An existing fence
6 feet high here, completely opaque. And this is all fenced in, there's woods behind here, and then, you know, tree line all the way around. So what I was thinking was we could have the fence go behind the thickest part of, you know, sort of where he's a little bit out of sight here, and that. So he's got the fence behind him, and then the new fence reinforcing that, and then he's facing the backyard where it's all treed in to begin with. And maybe, you know, for the neighbor's side, we could do a partial block here or something, but there's really no way to see anything.
He gets along with the neighbor's dogs. Yeah.
So you're going to purchase fence for four sides?
Right. It would be four-sided. And then cement bottom.
Okay.
And then we'd secure in, you know, reinforce it along a couple of feet under the ground.
How does it get into?
So roughly, it's roughly 30 foot square.
That's a fair estimate.
Yeah, it says 125 feet. So
well, that's sort
30
of thinking
square.
30 foot square.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
And then
which is good size.
How he gets from here to here, we could also work on that. Whether it's sort of like a partition or a really secure runner. Chris said like a 300 pound chain is the rule of thumb. We go from the house to here, so he's safe, and then, like I said, I come and take him on hikes and stuff with a muzzle.
Yeah, right.
Your thoughts?
Well, I spoke with Chris at length, and he actually didn't realize how many times the dog had bitten when he initially had talked with the Sheehans.
Actually, I talked to him four times. I told him every time. So.
You talked to him today.
let her finish, and feel free to refute. But let her finish, please.
Again, I feel more confident with a solid fence instead of a chain link fence. There should be no runner in this dog's life because of his aggression issues. He should always be handled on a leash, just as the restraining order states, and has been in effect since 2015.
So you mean brought from the house into the
entire? And this last incident was because he was out on a runner.
I have to say, I just read that again, and the wording of your restraining order from 2015 doesn't specifically say that, but you can interpret it that way now. But
well, that's not my order, that's the Board of Selectmen's
order. Okay, well, whatever, the one that I have right here in my hand, after you stated that, you know, he wasn't restrained properly. When I read it initially was, I went out and bought a heavy duty setup from a dog place, and it was more than strong enough to hold Buddy. But that's not going to happen again. We're not going to do the run. You don't want to on a runner. We'll put on a runner. And we'll just walk him with a muzzle. And he's in the house most of the time, anyways. I mean, he's in the house. He's only outside an hour or two a day right now, the way it is.
So then, if that's the case, I know he doesn't get visuals. You know, to Hillary's point about visual stimulation, what's the hesitancy on a solid structure fence as opposed to a chain link fence?
We'll work.
It just struck me as being not right. I never thought about doing it this other way.
But I actually brought this up.
Yeah. Mm.
Yeah, we went out and we got an estimate from this place here.
And the owner of Colonial said that they've had similar conversations with people who've had dog issues and they have to secure their dog. This is the standard Colonial Fence Company fence for dogs that have problems.
I think Colonial and I have a disagreement about how we feel about the visual part of it, but I'm open to it, to discuss it.
I think, even my dog, when I let out the back, if it sees a squirrel, it can't catch him because it's got an electronic fence and another fence, but it bombs after him. So, maybe it's stimulating form of fun, but I don't know. She chases the birds, too. Sure. So, I couldn't see that, even when the neighbor drives down the driveway. Now, she runs out and starts barking at the car coming down the thing.
Yeah.
I guess my dream would be if I had money, I'd put an 8-foot high fence because the sun gets in there. I'd have a stockade so I couldn't see it.
Hmm.
Just so the dog, because I think it drives her more crazy, like outside playing. She's not mean. She's not aggressive that way. She's territorial in one sense that, we used to have no one there, and we have a house behind us now, so, causes her to bark. And again, if I had extra, I'd just build a high fence. Not that I don't want to see my neighbors, it's just nice to have the dog, the dogs in there,
All these incidents were basically my own responsibility. It's, we're the human beings here. I have to fix this from ever happening again. That's why we worked on this plan.
Yeah, and we're not blind, completely blinded by our love for our dog either. If he had attacked a person, we wouldn't have fought this, at all. We wouldn't have shown up.
I've always believed that if a dog ever bites a person, he's got to go. He's never been a person.
I think as you can probably tell, this is the worst things we do here in our night job. It's just a fear in Hillary's fear. If it ever happens again, how do I answer? How do I to the residents say, this dog is got out and maimed or hurt or killed a dog. You wouldn't want that, obviously. No, you can't come back from that. That's I think what I struggle with. I'm sure Jim struggles with that same issue. One, because we have dogs and love dogs.
No, I agree.
Can I say something?
Absolutely.
I mean, I just you say that if a dog attacked another person, it would be put down immediately. But to me, lifelong dog owner, a dog is a member of my family too. I mean, I've had my dog attacked. Same kind of situation, walking down the street with my dog on a leash and a dog has attacked my dog. Now my dog has issues and I have to be careful about it because that dog is now scared of every other dog that comes up to it. So just because it's only attack dogs, you know, I'm...
Well, don't get me wrong.
It's not fair to the other people who own dogs.
Valid point. I've had five dogs since I live in Norfolk. And this is the first dog that has gotten to this point here. But, you know, we've had incidents in the past with other dogs, minor things, but not like this. But it's a special thing, and who knows when you get a rescue dog. But we're willing to work with him. We're willing to put money into him and invest in him and work with you guys. And I think we have a good plan here. And, you know, there's a lot of history with Buddy and our family. And there's a photograph from there when he was visiting my mother with Alzheimer's. It broke the ice every time we go to see her. And having Buddy there was a big help for our family. So they become part of your family.
Yeah, and I agree. I guess my concern is, similar to Hillary's, you know, you've gone from an enclosure, which is the house, and we've still had four incidents. Now you're going to have an enclosure this is going to be the house and the fence. Maybe it's not Buddy's fault, but how do we guarantee that this isn't going to happen anymore?
Well, right, so the previous situation wasn't just the enclosure being the house. It was us putting him outside on a runner that was inadequate, or tying him up to the truck when we're working on trucks in the driveway, whatever, and he could get away easily. That was the wrong thing to do. So that will never be a situation that happens again. So it goes from the enclosure that's in the house now to a secured second enclosure, but the outdoors, which never happened before.
And we're in a different situation here. We're in front of you guys. This has never happened before. You know, we're taking this very seriously. So we're at a different place right now where we feel about this also. So.
Well, you can be sure we're just like you. We're residents of Norfolk. You know, and these are, at least for me, and I know Scott shares it, these are some of the most uncomfortable things we have to get involved in. They're just terrible. I have rescue dogs. I have two rescue dogs. I've had rescue dogs my whole life. And I'm like Jack. They're members of my family. And I would not want them hurt. I've got nine grandchildren. So if I had a dog that I had any concerns about, that dog would not stay in my home. It just wouldn't happen. As much as I love them, I can't put a child at risk. I feel the same way about another dog. That dog is someone else's family member, and we can't allow that family member to be at risk for a dog that's out of control. On the same vein, I want to compliment you on you obviously care deeply for the dog. I don't think you'd invest $5,000 on a fence if you didn't really want to try and make it right.
Training also.
As they said, I dislike these so intensely because it's just, you know.
I mean, until Hillary's point, it sounds like she's, you know, requesting a specific type of fence that we could work with.
We have to close every loophole we can think of to prevent this incident from happening again.
Yeah.
If there's a way to do that, that has, and nothing's perfect, I understand that, but if we can get as close to perfect as we can get, you know, what I'm hearing is a very strong, sincere effort to try and make it work, but you've got to do something to close every loophole. I'm concerned about the fence location, which is why I asked you to draw it. If it were attached to the house, where there could be a direct entry from the house to the enclosed area, that eliminates one opportunity for the dog to get away. It does. It just takes one.
I'm just thinking about the money factor.
Well, I understand, but you know, you have to make that decision. That's your decision to make. Our decision is to protect someone else's dog.
Well, here's the thing. We have talked to many people since this happened. Chris being one of them. Talked to the part-time dog officer over in Dover that Hillary knows. He has a great example of a pen in his own yard that I took photographs of. They both feel like we have a good plan. You know, I think we do have a good plan. Now we can adjust it, you know, but I think that we've worked at it, we're sincere. We've been pet owners my whole life.
Yeah.
So.
No, I agree. I mean, if we could, so is what you're saying, if we come up with a plan that has as close to perfect as possible in your eyes, that we could move forward with it?
Well, I'm not a dog trainer. You know, I'm just a dog owner, have been my entire life, so I'm not going to pretend to be what I'm not. But common sense would tell me that any time there's an opportunity between a defined enclosed area where you do have some security and the house. And doors can be left open in houses. I mean, I've had, if my slider is, you know, I've got a lab, a golden lab. Mm-hmm. And if she sees a squirrel in the backyard and it's just a sliding door, I can't tell you how many sliding doors I've replaced in my house. You know, just right through it.
We have a black lab in the house, same thing.
That kind of thing concerns me. That, you know, if there's a dog that's passing through, wandering, dogs do get loose. You know, leash laws aside, they do get loose, they do wander. The dog wanders through your backyard and you've got a sliding door and the door's open, don't know whether you do or you don't, but there's a screen there. My 60-pound lab can go through it pretty easy. I suspect a 90-pound dog is going to go through it even easier. That's what I'm concerned about, is if there's a way that we can eliminate that risk, if there's a defined area that the dog has to remain in or something. I'm not sure, Hill, you're probably better at expressing this than I am, but something that closes those loopholes, that's what I'm concerned about. Because we can't, I would feel very, I'm going to feel lousy about this either way, but I would not be doing what I think our responsibility is if this happens again. So how do we prevent it? And if we can prevent it, I think you're sincere in trying to do that. So I have to look to your guidance as to how to do that.
I think you said, you know, hit the nail right on the head as far as, you know, there's an access in and out of that house. If that's where the dog is going to be coming and going from, I think it should be surrounded with a fence. That way there are no accidents, the dog doesn't get away. And, you know, that could work. But I agree that that type of fence system, which is encompassing that access, is a much safer approach than bringing the dog out on a leash.
Yeah, and the guys at Colonial were great. They said I could modify it after we spoke with you tonight, and I can definitely go back to them in the morning and have something new.
You're talking thousands of more dollars.
I don't know if it would be. It's just the same.
You have to cut a hole into the house, put it indoors. I think all we really need to do is a little common sense, use a cane leash, walk the dog to the pen, and walk him back.
He's saying it's not acceptable.
Well, I'm not saying he's saying it. He's just thinking about it. That's my opinion, but if that's going to be the restriction that you got to impose on us, then, you know, we can probably figure out a way to do it.
Is there another location you can put the fence that's on a door?
Well,
the only location would be behind.
Not really.
On the screen, the porch. Right?
You have to cut a hole into the back porch and make an access for the dog to go in and out.
Porch sucks anyway.
Built that porch.
Can I ask you another?
Yeah.
There were some of the incidents, there were reports of you offering to pay vet bills for other residents. Has that all been squared up?
Yes, it has.
Okay. Except for the newest one, because they don't have a copy of that bill yet.
No, right. But they know that it's...
Right. I have it here for you.
Yeah. We've already had contact with them, and she's been reassured that, as always, I'll pay the bill.
Now, the last victim dog owner couldn't be here. She's actually overseas. So did you have a chance to read her statement?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. Do we have I think comments also from, you grab a microphone and identify yourself.
My name is Sherry Fair.
It's for the home audience, not for... Yeah.
My name is Sherry Fair, and I might struggle to get through this. During Hillary's presentation, I was very upset, and I was maybe the first person that this happened to, and I've been a resident of Norfolk for the last 30 years. I've been on Naugatuck Ave for 23 years. I'm a Norfolk employee. I work at the H. Olive Day School as a teacher assistant.
Thank you.
And I have a golden retriever. I've had three golden retrievers over my life, and I was walking Finnegan on a leash by your house when Buddy came tearing out, and it's probably one of the most traumatic things I've ever had happen to me. He flew in the air and latched onto my dog and bit him all over his face, wrapped me up. I fell backwards. You came running out and you kicked my dog, trying to separate them, but you, with your hard boot, you kicked my dog right in the face. I was shaking and crying. I had blood all over me. And you said, I will take care of anything. Please, I'm so sorry, everything. I struggled home with my dog from Day Street to Naugatuck, limping along. Sat with him for like 2 hours sobbing because I had no one home with me. Couldn't reach anybody. We tried to call you. We tried to send you letters. We stopped by your house. Never did I hear one word from you. You did not help pay for any vet bills.
I don't have any record of that.
Let her finish.
We slipped a note under your door. We knocked on your door.
No, I came to your house. We met in your little
really?
Entranceway.
Yeah. Yep.
And do I have some?
Oh, I gave you the bills.
Oh, yeah. We had, but let me just say.
We were the first incident. So I called not to get anyone in trouble. I just called to put it on record.
Yeah. After we tried to contact you.
And I did come. We met in your little entrance.
I don't remember this.
Mr. Lehan, I just want to speak to you because I appreciate what you said, and Mr. Hathaway also. He is a member of my family. And I didn't walk my dog for a year after that. I don't walk my dog anywhere near your neighborhood. I tell all my friends, everybody I know who has children, not to come near your house. I've been there and I've seen Buddy. I don't trust him. I don't mean to be unkind, but I don't trust what you're saying about taking care
I'm
of
really
any
sorry,
business. I'm
sorry
too,
yeah.
But it's been quite a few years, and yeah. I fully support. I love dogs, but I fully support what Hillary says, and I worry. I work in kindergarten. And I have quite a few Norfolk residents who've moved into Day Street and Noon Hill. And I have to tell them about Buddy. And I worry that they're going to walk by your house and Buddy's going to make a mistake. And it will be that 1 hour that you just took him out for a little breather and you weren't watching him. And he's gonna attack a child.
I apologize. I don't have a memory of this. I don't have any. But I would like to talk to you about that later and anything you come up with.
I'm not interested.
Okay, that's fine.
I'm just here to support Hillary.
Yeah. I wish I had a recollection of that, but I don't have the paperwork
or
anything.
I have a recollection big enough for both of us.
Okay. Well, if you have any paperwork, I'd love to see it. Okay. Again, I apologize, but I don't have a recollection or paperwork on it. I will say this. There was a time. What year was this?
2013.
Yeah, I may not have even been there at the time. I was in and out for a while. So.
No, you and I met at your house.
Yeah. I wish I could remember the incident. I don't remember it.
So it just shows how devastating, even if it's the mentality of it's just the dogs that get into the tussle, everybody involved gets hit as far as being affected by seeing their dog attacked. And this party right here is exactly what Anne Moran and her fears are as well, as she wrote in her statements. So I do stand by my first recommendation, but I'm willing to work with a fence that is solid structure and attached somehow to the access door where Buddy goes in and out.
Okay.
Sir? Yes, good evening. My name is Andrew Langhauser. I'm the person who separated the dog on this last incident. I'm sorry to hear about the first incident, although I really can't speak to it, because I was not a witness. I live right across the street. I walk my dog twice a day on Day Street. And there are kids on bikes playing, and I have not witnessed any incidences other than what happened a couple weeks ago. I heard Ann in trouble. I was able to separate the two dogs with relative ease. I was able to walk Buddy into the house to remove him from the scene. He was a little bit bloody too, but he calmed down pretty quick. He did respond to my commands, although he does know me to a little degree, as Gary and I do walk the neighborhood. I think that for the most part, that other dogs in the neighborhood get along with Buddy very well. Why these incidents happen is difficult to say. But I know Gary to be a very responsible dog owner. He's had dogs for the 20 plus years I've known him. He takes this very seriously, and that he commits to do something to try to make this better. He will follow through with it.
Anybody else? Tim, Jack, no?
Just a comment. If you can, I would like to see you have the opportunity to make it successful. But I have to ask that it comply with whatever Hillary thinks is within reason, you know, without being unreasonable, to really minimize the risks associated with this. But with a clear understanding that if there is even any type of incident of this nature again, there is no second consideration. It can't happen. So if you think, Hillary, that there's something here you can work with, and you're a pretty good judge of this, if you think there's something you can work with these folks, I do hear you're trying. I compliment you on that. It's hard. It's hard on both sides. But we can't have people fearful of walking in front of someone's house. I mean, that's crazy. So there has to be something that allows you to feel more comfortable. I don't know how else to say it. To be able to walk in that, you can't be fearful of walking in your neighborhood. That's just crazy. And I've seen dogs. You know, everyone that's had a dog has had a dog fight at some point in their life. It happens for whatever reason, you know. But when there's a pattern like this, and I had a rescue dog one time that had a background unknown to me that made the dog very protective, and we had to not keep the dog. I just couldn't run the risk of having that dog in being an endangerment to other people or other dogs. Couldn't run that risk, as much as I love the dog. So I've been there. Now, we didn't euthanize the dog. We found a home. You know, there were in the farming community where it could live comfortably and not have that risk. But that's not Norfolk. So if this is my opinion, if you can find a way, because I, you know, obviously you want to try, or you wouldn't. I assume this is a fairly legitimate opportunity. You wouldn't have gone to this extent if you weren't trying. But it has to be pretty foolproof. And I'm not the best judge of how to design that. Logic would tell me it needs to be attached to the house, but I could be wrong. So I wouldn't define the perimeters of what would or would not work, but I would rely on Hillary to make that definition within reason.
Well, I agree with you. And I know Hillary's doing her job. But I'm also thinking about other people that are like Chris Wider.
Hillary is our dog officer. Right. She's the one that works for us.
So I'm looking for advice from him too. But because,
well, that's fine, but she's our voice of authority here.
And just a reminder, you know, 22 years in the job, and I actually have taught Chris Wider at the Animal Control Officer Academy. So we're very, very good friends, and yeah, we both share all the same knowledge.
Mr. Sheehan, what we can't get into is a debate as to who's right. Because there are a variety of opinions. So, you know, this is the town of Norfolk. Hillary is our animal control officer. This is her role, her responsibility, and she's very experienced at it. We've had, in the 12 years been on this board, I think we've had 3 dog hearings. They're all painful because we all love our dogs. They're all painful. But I have found Hillary to be extremely thorough.
So we're really close on how we agree. I just have this one little, I have to figure out the cost of trying to do this from the house to the pen.
I understand. Mm-hmm. And I fully understand. That's a trade. Mm-hmm. I don't know how to weigh that for you.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll have to get a couple of new proposals, and we'll figure it out.
When will the training start?
They said so I got that, I think, late last week. They said they could have come out this week. And so tomorrow's Wednesday. They could probably come out by Saturday.
So the dog is confined now.
Right.
Completely confined. He's in the home. Not loose at any time.
Right. No. And when I have had him out in the yard, I put a muzzle on him. All the time. I'm going to get a better muzzle. It's a cloth one. I'm going to go with a plastic one that you can actually eat and drink out of.
Yep.
And you will
continue
to do that at all times when the dog is outside.
That actually eliminates, you know, any sort of, but it kind of eases him too. He knows he can't do anything when he has that on. It helps.
Yeah.
Is there something here you can work with?
I think so. I think what we first need to do is, by the way that the law is written, is the board needs to determine if he's a dangerous dog or a nuisance dog or dismiss the complaint. And then once you categorize what he is, then we can go through the levels of remedy, a insurance policy for the dog, microchipping the dog, in case he's transferred to another organization, and they can find that, you know, the bite history elsewhere.
Not somebody else's problem.
Exactly. You know, we don't banish dogs anymore because it's just like moving wildlife. It becomes somebody else's problem and issue. As far as the fence, I can certainly get a plot plan from Betsy tomorrow and put something together and email it to the Sheehans. You know, in a perfect world, it would be great if you had enough money to enclose the whole property and Buddy could just have the run of the place, because he does deserve to have exercise. He needs it. But I understand that, and I, you know, I'll keep my fence plan in proportion to safety from the back door and, you know, what you guys can afford. If it's going to be, you know, 25 square feet or 25 feet by 10 feet, but something that eliminates the risk that this dog is going to get loose again.
That agreeable to you?
Sure.
Yes. Thank you.
And in the meantime, I would ask that, you know, obviously they're doing the right thing with having him muzzled when he's outside now, which is great, that the restraining order take effect, stay in effect, and that what did I say already? Liability policy for the dog, because he's not covered under their homeowners.
You have
I got that. It's in the folder.
Oh, okay. Yeah. It's all, oh, I thought it said he was exempt from coverage.
No.
They have the they have the coverage.
Okay. Good.
I don't know. He's not microchipped, though?
Not yet. Okay. We can do that.
Okay. Fantastic. And that, what are we going to have for a timeline for installing the fence? I mean, just, we got to do this before the ground freezes.
Well, that gives us quite a bit of time, but I want to get it done sooner rather than later, but I don't know exactly. It could take a few weeks. Now we're going to change it around a bit, but in the interim, we'll keep him secure in the house. And if he does go out, I'll take him out on a chain leash with a muzzle. And when we get the fence done, I'll have you come over. Or before we get it done, you got to work on that. I'll work with Hillary on this, as long as she has the time to do it with me.
I'm at your disposal, 8 to 4.
Okay.
Are you comfortable with that?
Well, can I ask something just before you answer that? Because with other dog hearings, we've talked about escape points from the house. I mean,
right.
There are no young kids, I don't think, here, right? So that's good. You know.
Do you have a sliding door?
No. Oh, no. No sliding doors.
No. Oh, he's never... Everything's been out. Every incident's happened when he's been outside, tied up to the runner or a truck. But I know what you mean. We can go around the house and figure out if there would be any. You know, if he was redirecting his energy, what would be the most likely spot?
Yeah. Well, I will say this: since we got the lab in the house a year or so ago, for the most part, it's been a lot.
Yeah, but there's been an incident 2 weeks ago. But
I know. He can stay in the house all day with the lab's 10 years old, and. He sleeps most of the day now.
So the answer, I'm not comfortable with it, but I'm willing to work with it.
What's your opinion?
I want to give it, you know, I think it's more than it, I think every dog is worth the shot. I mean, but again, I still struggle with the incidents and, you know. It's just no guarantee it won't happen again. I mean, just taking every precaution here. I'm really curious about the training. I'd like, you know, I don't know if Hillary can monitor that weekend or, you know, curious what the training when they get in with the dog, they start to say.
Yep.
You know,
yeah, it could happen.
I hope that, you know, they're trying to take your money and say it's not a lost cause. I mean, I'm hoping they're honest. And if they say it's in the best interest of society and the dog, that you'll listen, and we'll listen.
Your dog, Buddy, is a male, right?
Right.
Were these other dogs female?
No. Well, Jake is not a female. Male. The cockapoo, I believe, was a female.
I'm not a dog expert, but what I've always understood is that dogs that do attack other dogs, you know, I mean, sometimes males will
may not too comfortable with each other or mm-hmm. things of that nature. But I also hear that this dog gets along with other dogs.
Mm-hmm.
What makes a dog pick and choose like that?
You know, I can't answer that. I mean, their genetic makeup is made up either from a young experience that is traumatic, an older experience that is traumatic. Animal behaviorists are now saying that some genetic triggers are actually caused in utero.
But so, how does a trainer deal with that? I mean, that's, it's just, it's...
Well, there's a couple different schools of thought. It's dependent on the totality of the circumstances with what are all the triggers that are setting a particular dog off. Is it the sound of a chain going by, the pads of the feet of the dog going down the sidewalk? Is it a smell? Is it a sight? Is it sound? I mean, there are so many different triggers. And, you know, to date, I've never been able to get a dog to actually, like, tell me why they get that way. However, it's just learning how to manage those triggers without diminishing their quality of life. You know, once they have a biting situation, you can't take that bite back. And what we've seen from the beginning to now is the dog bites have escalated. I mean, if you look at this latest Golden,
that's clear. Yeah.
That was clear cut.
I agree.
And that is why I am not comfortable with a fence, but I will put something together.
I mean, that's the part that honestly worries me, is that I did look at the escalation of the bites and looked at the, and I do know enough about to know this much, that an argument or disagreement between two dogs where there is obvious biting and things of that nature, that's different than in a dog actually trying to kill another dog.
Correct.
There's a whole different attack mode to that dog when it's trying to kill another dog. And that's when it flips it on its back and goes for the neck.
Correct.
And that's what happened on this lack attack.
Correct.
And that concerns me.
Absolutely.
Well, if you think there's an opportunity to try and fix this, I would be okay with that. Well, first we have to designate. This dog is a dangerous dog by any stretch of the definition, by my standards. Now, I believe that allows you to take the action that we want you to take. Is that correct?
Correct. So under, I think I gave you guys a schedule of...
They do.
Yeah, Mass General Law, 140, Section 157.
So if it's deemed a dangerous dog, you have a list of remedial actions that are at your disposal through state law. I would recommend microchipping, the fence, and, you know, anytime...
The muzzle leash.
I would do is it 600 tensile leash?
It's a minimum of 300.
Okay.
But not to exceed not 3 feet.
Not exceeding 3 feet in length.
Right.
That way you can keep under control. Yeah.
Correct.
Okay.
Have the insurance. The chip. And no more tying, right? You won't tie them up.
And can we, I mean, this fence can't wait too long. I mean, right. I understand you're at the whim of the installation company, whoever that might be, Walpole Fence.
Colonial. It's a time sensitive
issue. Local guys. Mm-hmm. So you probably get
and
pretty
good
service.
I like Colonial.
Yeah, and if, you know, if it has to be the same plan with different installation, then that's what we'll have.
So I can easily get a drawing over to the Sheehan's via email, you know, by Thursday, and you know, they can go talk to Colonial. I would say, you know, let's see if we can get this to work, but we also have to have a plan B if it does not.
I don't think there is a plan B. Well, there is a plan B, but it's not one we like.
Right.
Actually, I do have another one.
I'm sorry. The shelter I adopted him from said they would take him back at any point, no matter what what he's done. And it's a no-kill shelter. If there's ever another issue, we would just bring him. We would transport him down to that shelter and give him up, relinquish him to them.
It's Potter's League out of Rhode Island.
There was actually just a legal case in Massachusetts in the last 2 years. A dog was deemed dangerous in a town that was a rescue dog, and that rescue dog. The rescue said that they would take that dog back after the dangerous dog hearing. The animal control officer in the town disclosed to the rescue why it was deemed a dangerous dog. And when that dog went back into the rescue on the first day, it attacked one of the rescue workers. And the animal control officer was sued, and so was the town, for allowing that dog to go back into the rescue. So there's so many, you can sue a ham sandwich in Massachusetts, so I understand that.
But you can.
I do not, I would not like to partake in that type of a situation.
Yeah, I personally agree. I don't think, I understand why you would want to do that, but you're just passing on the problem to someone else.
Well, I've told them about the incidents with Buddy, and they said they want to train him, and there's no kill shelter. It's a fabulous place. You could Google it and look at it.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with it.
It's better than euthanizing the dog, which we don't want to have happen. But anyways, we're not even there. I want to move forward with Rob. It's really Rob's dog. Yep. And
I assume you can't have dogs in Boston, Rob. Is that the issue?
Yeah. South Park doesn't like that.
Yeah.
South Boston, small cases. So. But we're going to, you know, mainly we're just going to work with everything that Hillary comes up with, and we're going to put it into action. And we're on the same page. We don't want anyone to be nervous. We can't take back what's happened now. We can only control what we're going to do from today forward. And I think you guys will be happy with what we do.
Can I make a recommendation, sure. Mr. Chairman? We have a meeting in 2 weeks. Can we get a status report back from you in 2 weeks, if that's agreeable?
That'd be great.
That hopefully these steps have been, I'm sorry? October 18th. That these steps have been taken and accomplished, or at least well on the way.
Okay.
And that you have a higher level of comfort that we've taken the right steps.
Yep.
In the meantime, conforming to all of these considerations is a given.
100%.
Because if it does happen again, I would, as painful as it is, I would say the dog has to be put down. If it's brought, at least my view, I'm speaking only for me, is, and that is very painful for me to say. It would be very painful for me to say.
No, we respect that. We're just going to prevent. We won't let that happen.
If something does happen, what is the board's wishes in the interim?
There's an attack on another dog or a person?
Or running loose or violating the restraining order? What would you like? Would you return the dog back to the owner, put it into a boarding facility, or what?
If it got loose, it's not going to get loose if it does.
Right. I'm just thinking, no, I'm covering all the bases here so that if something does happen, I know what you want.
Well, I think the extreme is if there's another attack.
Yeah.
You know, at least from my perspective, that message is clear. That
okay.
If there is another attack, if your dog gets loose and there's another attack on another dog, then forget the fence. That's just my opinion. And it is very painful, Mr. Shan, for me to say that. Believe me.
It's been very stressful for us, too, believe me. We don't want this to happen.
This is the worst part of this volunteer job.
And also, can we put in the order that they pay the veterinary bill?
Oh, absolutely.
And on
oh,
the
yes.
Left.
Yeah. And any past due bills. That
I have spoken with Ann Moran, and I'll broker that to make sure it happens if she returns from Italy.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Jack, you got something else?
Just to answer Hillary's question, if the dog becomes loose, because I would just recommend that the dog be, boarded.
Boarded.
I think that's a good suggestion.
Second hearing.
Right.
Okay.
Agreed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you
for your time.
Thank you, everyone.
Sorry. Boy, these are painful.
Yeah.
Swan, S-Q-U-A-N.
I give them, Earthling. The sun was I give them credit. They're trying.
Yeah.
I'll pass it along to Rob.
Okay.
I hope we did the right thing.
I live in fear now. Like, I'm in fear of that. Yeah, again, yeah, I shouldn't, yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you. Mr. Sheehan, I hope we all have done the right thing here, but it's in your hands.
I agree.
We're going to fall through.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Hillary. Thank you, Officer.
Hillary, thank you. Officer.
Thank you, James.
Have a good night.
Nice to see you again. James, are you still the low man on the totem pole, or are you number two?
At your height and size, you could be number one anytime you want.
Thanks, I appreciate
have you
it.
I don't know if you've officially met the selectman, have you?
I don't think so.
No. Hi. Jim, this Officer, good to see you.
Hi, Jim.
Nice to see you.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well. Welcome.
Great to see you again, sir. You too. We don't get to see you much. So.
Well, what shift does he get? Like the great, I don't know what's best.
He sleeps during the day, I'm sure.
Oh, you got the night shift?
Yep.
Oh, my sympathy.
As long as Jimmy has
to stay. Well, keep us safe, will you please? Keep us safe.
Thank
you.
That's the plan.
When does Jimmy? All right, so how many Jimmys have we fired in a row now?
Yeah.
Do you think? I mean, I'm.
When does he graduate?
They're trying. They're really trying. Now we'll see. But if that dog gets loose again,
I hope they go. I missed yours. I'm sorry, but I like to go to those.
Right.
Yeah, no, it was a good show. Yeah.
I don't know why Rob became involved.
I'm guessing that the son involvement has made a change in this.
No, I agree with that.
Okay. And that might be enough to make it work. Because that's what gave me the sort of empathetic approach, is I think the son really wants to. I heard a lot of sincerity in that conversation.
Oh, I agree. I absolutely.
I mean, there wasn't anything. There was no pretext. There was no defense. There was a full acknowledgement of the issue and a sincere effort to try and make it right. So I think.
But Hillary's point of why now. I think the son, for some reason, son wasn't must not have been as much involved or financial as involved. I assume it's more financial.
I wish the son lived with the dog.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do too.
That's why I was asking my boss. I mean, that's like banishment.
There's no question that the son.
Did I say that a lot?
No, I didn't. Or get a bigger apartment in South
son,
Boston,
the son
right?
Was very sincere. I give him credit.
It was very.
No, I agree.
It's the reason I acquiesced. I think to a certain degree is I think the son really wants to make it work, and I think he'll do his best to do it.
I thought your comment at the end was great to Mr. Sheehan, asking him if we did the right thing. So I think that hit home for him.
Mm-hmm. Well, I hope so.
I hope so too.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Have a good night. You too.
Those are painful.
Yeah, my stomach hurts now. That was great.
Yeah, I struggle with that, you know. And
you get the dog, yeah, they get attacked. Like, I felt bad for the couple of the first instance, you know.
When I read the report, I was pretty much at the conclusion that we had no alternative. And yeah. I think if the son had not been here, I think I would still have been in that position. But I did hear a sincere effort to try and fix it, but yeah,
as long as they adhere to Hillary's, I know he doesn't want to cut into his house, but that's money he has to spend.
That is now up to them,
right?
I mean, you know,
no, I know, you know, and it's not easy. I mean, that, you know, like I said, I would, you know,
and I'm sure there are a multitude of opinions as to what the right answer is, but we have one person that we rely on,
well, and we have to protect the public,
not,
like you said,
it's not a communal decision.
Put your dog, you know, your love of animals aside, no animals should be put down, but I don't know. All right, Jack. We're off that now. Did we finish up with the on the public safety? Yeah. We're good there.
I know you wanted to. I know you wanted to keep it late. I mean, early because Jeff's not here, so you didn't want to get into a lot of stuff.
Yeah, I don't want to. You know.
Yeah, I know we have some. Well, I don't know if you want to talk. I think we killed the public safety bill, unless you have something else.
I'm not sure I'd quite word it like that. But yeah.
Killed the topic anyway.
Yeah.
And then the other.
Southwood.
Southwood. So we're continuing with Southwood, and you know, we're still moving forward. We plan on we have the warrant article now drafted. We had a meeting of the zoning working committee yesterday, and that seems like 2 days ago. That was yesterday, and yeah, you know, we're still coming to grips with all the documents and you know, feeling comfortable enough that we can go to town meeting and stand and sell this, you know, and I only mean that, you know, I'm not, I mean what I say. I think, you know, we're almost there, and, you know, we have to be, and Jim's word yesterday, nothing is ever going to be 100% foolproof, and now I'm not using your exact words, but, we have to get it to a point where we're close enough that we think, you know, we can go at this
and get the product that we're looking for. You know, it's a reasonable deal, I guess, is the. And I think I butchered what you said yesterday.
No, because you can't contract everything. You can't put in writing every contingency, every.
That's the problem. We've tried to say, well, what happens if this? What happens if this? What happens if this? So we've tried to cover all of the contingencies.
Right. You have to cover.
What happens if he sells this piece of property? What happens if he does this product first and leaves us with nothing on the other side? So we've tried to cover all those things, and I think we've done a good job with it. It's, you know, and then we're working by committee too. So it's, you know, that's a lot of fun too. Yeah.
Now, how about the issue, you know, of the set, you know, maybe it's like, did he, like, they were going to, you know, perking and testing, like, the septic, has that been resolved, or is it still?
He's done enough testing to provide, I think, the committee, well, the people that really know, the Board of Health and Ray, he's done enough testing for us to at least be comfortable that he can get, if not all, some of this project completed. He's still got to go through the whole planning board process.
I know there was concerns, you know, people raised about, like, you know.
I think we've crossed that bridge sufficiently for this stage of the development, I guess is the way
test,
to say it.
You know,
yeah.
You know, can it really have 200 years?
He's done a good amount of that work. What we struggle with is, and I think the group has been really trying hard to look at all of the different considerations on this, that you know, the what ifs. And, you know, the problem is you never know what you don't know. And so as we've gone through this process, which is now like 2.5 years, and it's been very concentrated over the last 4 months, there's been a lot of headbutting.
Yeah.
A lot. And
amongst ourselves and with him.
Yeah. Very well said. I mean, not all in agreement here, and certainly not with him. So it hasn't been all wine and dining by any stretch of the imagination. But I do think that we got... I think part of the problem was that sometimes when you try to close all these loopholes, you overcomplicate the process. Mm-hmm. And I think we, as we continue to work through this, well, the what ifs, I think we did begin to overcomplicate mm-hmm. it. And I think what happened in this last meeting was that we took a step back and said, well, what is it we really need to take care of? You know, what are the real critical points? Because we can't cover them. There'll always be a leak someplace, always. Some leaks you can live with. Some leaks you can't. So what are the ones we can't live with? You know, and the two major issues to us are affordable units and the phasing of those affordable units so that we have assurances that we get the affordable units. And one of the members of the committee came up with a very simplistic concept that was so simple you'd sometimes wonder, how come we didn't think of that? You know, we were looking for the complicated answer, and he came up with a simple answer.
Give us
110. We don't care where, we don't care how, we don't care, you know, but there will be 110, period.
No matter what.
And I know that sounds simplistic, but in truth, it covers the issue.
Yeah.
You know, if we get 110 out of this, if you don't, we don't care whether we get them here, we don't care whether we get them in apartments, we don't care whether we bring them in townhouses, we don't care whether we get them in assisted, we don't care. And we were trying to define all that. And that's where it became so complicated. And truth is, we really don't care.
Right, it really shouldn't matter. I mean,
shouldn't matter.
I don't know if people have reservations about affordables being in the apartments. Yeah, you know.
They're going to be in the apartment. I mean, well.
Well, the trick to the apartments is that they're not all affordables, but if you can count them all, that's the benefit of the apartments. If you get 25% of them as affordable.
25%. I remember it was 25%.
If you get 25% of them affordable,
they all count.
They all count.
So that's a. There's a huge incentive for him to just make 25% of them affordable, because then he can rent out the market, you know, or he can sell the building with 75% market rate and get a lot more rent.
So we think we've got a solution that makes financial sense to him, but protects the town. And we've come a long way on the with the Archdiocese, on sort of a guarantee that if he walks, again, you know, perfect. It's pretty good, I think. I think we've got a pretty good understanding on that.
Yeah.
So from the Archdiocese standpoint, that if he walks in, you know, someone else comes in, he flips the whole deal or whatever.
They've agreed that if he walks and they sell it to someone else, that whoever that is, that it's conditioned on them either following the agreement or coming back and renegotiating with us.
We can get that legal, you know, is Archdiocese really bound by that? I mean, you know, they can say, oh, yeah, we said we'd do that, but, you know, John Smith walked in, he wants, you know, Hoboken's out and this guy came in, you know, and they just offered us so much money for the project.
Well, you've got, I mean, that question was raised, you know. I mean, well, you may end up in a lawsuit. Well, maybe. I mean, you know, I mean.
I just didn't know what the archdiocese
You've got a contract. You've got a contract with the archdiocese. You've got a signed contract by the archdiocese that says we agree to the following terms.
No matter who buys it, you know, in perpetuity, if you will.
In perpetuity.
As long as we pass the zoning.
Right. If we don't pass the zoning, it's irrelevant anyway. Yeah. So it's, and you know, the payment schedules, the well and the public safety considerations are all in there. Not the way we'd really like it. You know, we'd love to get it all up front.
Right.
To get it, have it placed in escrow and then paid in escrow with the archdiocese and then paid upon closure gives us, you know, pretty high level of comfort.
There's $1 million up front before zoning. And then there's a per unit fee after that.
It goes in escrow. I mean, if zoning doesn't change, it obviously doesn't change.
And that'll pay for the well.
Yeah.
So.
We have a well site for that? Do we have somebody where we want to invest that money?
We get closer. We do.
That one property we talked about before?
Yeah, close.
Holbrook Street?
Yep.
Has it, we done some testing on there?
Done a lot of testing.
Yeah.
With the bigger size, you know, 4-inch to 8-inch, or I don't know what size.
No, the next round of testing is in the spring. The bigger
but they've done multiple.
The seven-day testing with the big thing will be in the spring.
Yeah.
But the initial, we've had other places with initial ones look pretty good too, and they didn't pan out half that maybe. Yep. I mean, yeah, hold on, hope. Believe me, I want it.
I can only tell you what Bob said. He says it's the best site he's found.
We had a meeting with the DEP, and they were very good. Give some ideas, and so what we're trying to do with this well is. And there's still some tweaking that has to go along with that. But what we're trying to do with this well is not increase our daily withdrawal. So we're really, this is our redundancy well. So Bob can sleep at night well. So that if one of the other wells continues to go down or disaster strikes and one of the other wells goes down, you know, instantaneously, we still have the capacity to fulfill our daily needs. That's the kind of approach we're taking. And of course, if this well says it can get us, you know, millions and millions of gallons, we might rethink that and actually go through the longer permitting process of increasing our daily withdrawal amounts. But the thought is that this will be a well that will is really just meant for redundancy purposes and gets us through our first hurdle.
And it's a quicker permitting process.
Much quicker permitting process. And nowhere in Norfolk is there going to be an easy permitting process because the entire town is stressed aquifers. Area, as is much of, you know, the Charles River Basin. We're lucky that we're not up in the Essex, which is up on the North Shore, which is even worse. But the Charles River Basin is considered by the there. So there will be people fighting us. You know, the Charles River Advocacy Group will be fighting us, no matter what we do. But the DEP thought that it made perfect sense. Just so we're not looking to draw more than our permit allows. And our permit has an escalation.
Is a permit based on a number of like homes that want it? Because I mean, that doesn't. I was just going to ask. Obviously, where's that leave us? All these new developments.
The permit over the next 5 years already has an escalation built into it.
Based on perceived growth or just actual? They just take a number from like previous four and say,
our master plan and other Department of Conservation and Recreation. For some reason, they're involved. It's their numbers that. That they take into our master plan into account. So that's the thought right now is, and of course we'll be able to, you know, rethink this as we go, but that's the thought is to just get this to be the redundant well, and then go for upping our, especially if this and De Placido development become realities, we would then have to go and up all of our population projections and increase our withdrawal amounts, but you know, we think with all the work that the DPW has done over the past 6, 7 years, 8 years, that, you know, to contain all the leaks, and you know, we always kind of kid around that we used to pump for 2 Norfolks, now we just pump for 1. We're in great shape as far as our unaccounted for water down in the 5% range, which is just that's the industry best that you can get. DEP wants you to just be under 10.
and we used to be, you know, big double digits. We think we've got enough water. You know, our concern the last few years has been what happens if one of the wells goes out. You know, in our high peak days is a concern. That's obviously a concern in the summer.
And one of the well sites has been decreasing.
Well, the Spruce Road well site has been decreasing. We can't pull as much water as our permit allows. Okay. So that's, again, that's why adding a third well allows us just to get back up to what our permit allows.
The decreasing isn't because there's a lack of source. It's because, as I understand it, the mineral content has lined, if you will. It's like hardening of the arteries, right. You know.
Lining not only the pipe, but also the whole, you know, skeletal system, arterial system
coming.
Supply
is there. It's just it's harder to get it up because we've got a thinner source, thinner opportunity to get it up.
So if that one's under the permit, can't you just, again, maybe crazy question, can't Gold Street pump more there, or does it have the capacity? You know, there's just not enough water. You know what I mean? Like, say, because if we're allowed 250 gallons at Spruce and we're only pulling 125, can't we just add that increased capacity over to a good, a gushing level?
With some negotiation, each one.
Each one is permitted.
So there are different levels of permitting. So each well is permitted for a total withdrawal, and then our whole town is permitted for us.
Because I assume the DEP and others would argue that even though I think they're drawing maybe from the same source, they're going to say it's a little bit different source and it's under different permit.
So when you do the 7-day testing, you know, the Gold Street well is, you know, they're looking at the impacts around there. I mean, certainly you look at the Kingsbury Pond and what Franklin allegedly is doing to that. If they put all their pumping on that well, you know, Kingsbury Pond would just be a dust bowl.
Right.
Now it's just a mud puddle. Yeah. So we wish they would pump otherwise. So you can't just, you know, you have to pay attention to both those.
Right. No, I get it. I figured that was the case, just in case people wondered. I mean,
but there are averages too. You know, you can relax a well and over pump a well for,
because you're doing an average. So it's like, yeah.
So there's a monthly average you have to be aware of, and there are yearly averages you have to be aware of. So we can work a well harder while we're cleaning a well or doing some other work to it.
That brings up things, because I got a couple calls. I mean, even though it's rained for the past couple days, I assume the water ban, everything's still in effect?
Still in effect. There's still a drought condition.
Can you remind people, because I had one person, I'm sure you guys get calls too, people have some new lawns out there because this is the time to seed your lawn, right? But really, they really can't. I mean, one person I call, he's walking around in some neighborhood, and he just saw like three different brand new lawns sprinkled going like right in the midday.
Now, if you're connected to the municipal watering system,
going on in the middle of rainstorms. Yeah. I mean, it's just.
I just made him mad. Yeah, again, don't fight with your neighbors. I know this is the right time to do the seeding, so it's kind of catch-22 for people.
I wish it wasn't a drought. But if you're connected to the municipal water system, you can only be doing handheld sprinkle. Handheld sprinkler watering.
Are we forcing that at all? No. Do we know? I mean, if we go by, you know, someone sees someone should say something. See something, say something. I mean,
you should say something.
Well, the problem is you don't know whether they have a well or not.
I thought we can tell pretty easily.
Bob can, but someone driving by.
Right, no, yeah.
You don't know whether they have a well or not.
I don't encourage people to go knock on their neighbor's door.
Yeah, having them call up saying, well, my neighbor's got it. He may have a well. I mean, right. You don't know that. Yeah. Bob can tell. He can tell by water usage.
Does the person call Bob? Again, just David's asking for what we do
DPW.
About it.
Yeah. Certainly, we're not going to tell, you know, we'll call the DPW or call me.
And they can look it up and say, okay, this.
Yeah, well, we'll take action. We're not going to send the person. Oh no, they don't have a well. Go get them. You know, we'll go get them.
Oh, I know. Okay, that's what I was encouraging you. I don't want people to have conflicts with their neighbors. You have to live with people. But I mean, it just reminded me again because the season's for lawns, right? Fall, it's great to grow lawns if we had rain.
Awesome. Yeah,
if we had rain, we have the cool nights, but in warm days.
My grass has come back a little bit with the rain. I'm hoping.
I don't care.
Mine's a lost cause.
Yeah, I haven't had to mow. In a month,
twice. I think I mowed twice all season. So, again.
In May, it was like every 5 days I had to mow.
So, that's all right.
Get that out of my system. Hope my tractor still works.
Yeah, start it. It's like a generator. You should start it anyway. So,
we'll come over and test and see what's going on. Yeah.
Anything else? Mr. Hathaway.
I'm trying to think.
That's Mr. Hathaway.
Well, I know we've got some things to talk about the warrant, but we're going to wait for Jeff and then to the next meeting to do that.
Yeah, yeah. I don't think there's anything. Do you want to do any kills?
Are we going to have, I understand that Spectra is going to be on the agenda?
Yes.
So we should let folks know that it will be on our agenda.
I didn't think there's another meeting coming up at Stony Brook, too. Is it this week? Or those, you know,
I don't know.
That was posted on Facebook, yeah. Yeah. There's a group, yeah, that same group of concerned citizens.
Yeah. I think Jeff plans on putting it on the agenda for the 18th.
Yeah.
Is there any way, Jack?
Really?
I don't want to say definitive. Is there any way we can get any guidance at all? You know, if towns actually have any say in this, again, I'm not an expert. I haven't done probably as much reading as I should, or as Jeff has done, or even probably Jim. But because I read something in the paper, it's covered under FERC, and again, the statement in the paper was it doesn't. The towns have no say.
We don't have any. My understanding is, and there's always different lawyers' interpretations, but my understanding is we don't have any permitting say. Our conservation commission has, whatever impact they have.
Yeah.
But my understanding is they've already done a review of the property and they don't have
any issues
jurisdiction here. Yeah, nothing on the wetlands.
I mean, you can't make it up. It's either there or not there.
Right.
So.
I think the one thing that we can do is at least that somebody has forwarded to us, is that we can ask to become an intervener, I think was the word, so that we can get on the docket, basically saying that we want to have a statement. We have a concern, either a concern or I suppose you could be a proponent and be an intervener as well. But that's my understanding is that, so it's more of a political move than there's no permitting role that I'm aware of that we have. I've had a couple people call me and I've had conversations with that are, active in the issue. And that's what they've told me as well. They've asked us to get involved, politically. Of course, we could always, you could also argue too that we could create bylaws that make it difficult. But I don't, at this point,
I don't think they'd be binding.
I think the
Attorney General would say no, because it's going against like federal regulation. I mean, they have the right to.
Yeah.
I don't say the right.
It'd be creating a legal issue.
Yeah. Right. It's almost like spot zoning in that sense. And again, just so I'm clear. I mean, I know this is new and potentially it's a bigger size pipe, but there's already existing pipes going along the same trail that people are concerned about now. I mean,
correct.
And it's still the same evacuation area. I mean, again, small pipe, maybe smaller trouble or risk, but mm-hmm. it's still there today, right? Natural gas is passing right through these areas.
That pipe's been there 30 or 40 years.
I think Chuck said 46 years or something. I remember he came up with he's good with those things.
Well, the only, I think it'd be a good conversation. It'd be good to hear all sides of the issue, but the only thing, I had several people say, why haven't the selectmen got involved? I said, well, I don't know where we can get involved, number one. I mean, I don't, well, why don't you take a position? I said, well, are you saying we should take a position representing the community? Because that's our role. If we make a statement that, we're against this, that should reflect what the community's view is. And if we took a position for every 30 people that had an opinion, that's all we'd do. Mm. So, if this is the will of the community, which I think the state says you get 10% of the registered voters, I think, is what they use as a guideline.
At least put it on the ballot, yeah.
Yeah, or you could put it on the ballot as a question, a non-binding question. I mean, if there's some way to have that reflect the will of the community, then that's our role, is to reflect the will of the community. I'd be reluctant to take a position representing the town that represented less than that. Because I don't, regardless of my own personal views.
I agree.
So maybe putting the question on the ballot might not be a bad idea.
I mean, they have a petition going around, so they're up to
200 and some odd.
Yeah, 260,
as of
right?
What I saw the other
10%
day.
10% is what, 550 roughly?
650 roughly.
650?
Yeah.
So they're getting there.
Yeah, they are. But would it make sense to put it on the ballot as a non-binding question? Local ballot.
And what's the question?
A meeting or the spring ballot, you mean?
Well,
on the ballot.
The ballot.
Not
whatever.
Town meeting warrant. The town,
no,
the ballot.
not the warrant. No.
No, I think it would be good to put it on the ballot.
As a non-binding question. And I mean, that's the best way for the voters to...
Whether you for or against, is that as simple as that? I mean, what do you mean?
Well, yeah. I mean, in simplistic terms, you'd have to have some explanation around it and what it is. But you're saying, that you can either be for or against and you vote yes or no.
Yeah, it's hard.
And then based on
that... The state does that all the time.
Right.
The state does non-binding questions all the time.
And then based on that, then that's where we can make a statement.
At least you've given the voters a chance to express their views, and then, our role is to do what the voters tell us. that's one way to get it to the voters, is to put it on the ballot.
In May, you mean?
In May.
I guess people come on May, but we know more people
not
come
sure
on.
What the timing is for May.
When are they starting all this? I mean, it's still years.
I don't think there's construction until at least 2018.
Yeah, so May is not unreasonable.
I'm just thinking more people go.
Unless
to
they have their, I think don't know people, what the permit process is. That's,
I just think more people go to the polls in November, because we can't do it in November. You know, somehow get there.
If Carol left, I don't think you could add something to the. Be a little tight to get it onto the presidential ballot at this point.
Well, you're going to get more people. Well, you get better. You get even more.
Oh, yeah, you get more people to vote.
You get more representatives. Because, yeah. I mean, it depends what happens this come May, how many people will come out. Yeah,
but if people feel strongly about it, they'll show up. You know, if there are 700 people that feel.
No, this
no,
not,
Joe,
no.
Jeff's up.
Jeff.
Oh, that's right.
That's right.
But that's just one thought, that maybe we could put it on the ballot as a referendum question.
Sounds good. Makes sense.
I mean, I went on and read their webpage, the people that are against it. And there are a lot of links that they have there. I've gone to all the links and, so I understand what they're saying, but I didn't see anything that told me we had any meaningful role to play. We could take a position.
It's a political position is what they're looking for.
I know the Walpole Selectmen, I think, voted not to allow it to go within 1,000 feet of a wellhead.
400 feet.
400 feet?
Yeah.
Awfully
generous of them.
That's very generous, seeing as that's law.
Yeah, since you can't go there anyway.
Yeah.
I mean, again, unless I'm going to jog it a little bit, I thought it's just going along, literally, again, along an existing, not replacing it, but right next to an existing line. So, like I said, Walpole, they did something toothless.
They did something toothless. They did something.
But you know, all the same thing, it's going to be in the same footprint. I mean, it takes a minute to dig around.
At least what I read indicated that they would need to be taking some property, and that there would be individual, and which is not a town issue, but they would need to encroach because of the
size.
I think the right of way is not wide enough in certain areas to completely do what they want to do, and they'll have to negotiate with the landowners to.
So they have some eminent domain.
They can take eminent domain. Yeah.
So that might stress it out too. Again, it could slow it down. I mean, they don't have the money for it yet either. They get shot down the Supreme Court, which is nice if you're against it. The Supreme Court said you can't tax.
It may never happen.
Yeah. They still seem like before. The other pipeline bailed once they couldn't put it on the electricity bill.
Yeah.
This one seems to do it. I don't know whether they're going to come up with $3 billion, but that could be the hope. That's, I assume, is a dream scenario if you don't want it. Is that they decide they don't want to do it since they can't make people pay for it.
But we'll have a good discussion on it.
Mm.
I'm sure there'll be some folks that'll show up that would want to share their views.
Yes.
All right.
Anything else, Mr. Lehan?
You think of anything? We missed any?
You miss anything, Marion? Jack, you miss anything?
It's been busy. It seems like we're missing something.
I went to graduation yesterday.
Yesterday, yep.
Oh, firefighter.
Firefighter Getchell, yeah.
Firefighter William Getchell. It was great. It was a 10-week program. He had to go up to Stowe every day. So it was, 10 weeks, 5 days a week. He made it through, passed. So now he's a firefighter paramedic. He had passed his paramedic all his testing before that, so
welcome.
He's on board full speed ahead.
Yeah, I got down to the open house on Saturday, and we got a bunch of new guys.
Oh, there are. There's three new call firefighters.
Yeah, and several of them living in Norfolk now.
Yep.
Yeah,
which is terrific.
That
might actually work.
Three of the relatively new guys and lady have moved to Norfolk or are about to move to Norfolk, so that's great. And then three call firefighters are all local Norfolk gentlemen in that case. It's real good having.
They may
more
not need
and
you and Jim after all, then, Jack. You guys might have to suit up. I know you suited up once. You might have to suit up again.
I want
to
go. I did it once. That was great. That was a thrill. I'd do that again in a second.
I think.
I told Pete that I wanted to do that. That'd be great.
Well, our insurance company said no, but that's fine.
I'll sign a release.
Yeah. I think. Have you seen that show, Designated Survivor? Is that it?
Yeah.
Kiefer Sullivan?
I haven't watched it.
So he's the 11th...
I haven't seen it.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a great show. It just started. Kiefer Sullivan is he's the Secretary of Housing and Urban Development, and he is
He gets almost gets fired earlier in the day, and then that night the president has his State of the Union speech. So he is a designated survivor, so he's put off in a hotel, you know, across the other side of Washington, D.C., and
attack on the
Capitol building. And he is the 11th in the chain of command.
He's now the president. Yeah. It's a goofy premise,
so you're like the 11th fire, you know, 11th. Yeah. 11th
yeah. I'm the 11th guy. So if all the firefighters go down, I'm the 11th guy.
Yeah. Huh? God help us.
God help us. Yeah. Yeah.
I know you'd work hard at it. So you'd give it your all.
We'd try, but don't put you in.
I'm 12.
Yeah.
You're 12. Yeah. We did talk about doing something to recognize the public safety guys.
Yeah, I've been. Chuck has been talking to some of his guys, trying to find out a good date to do that. He's working on that for me. So.
Okay, and what about banners or signs?
You can do that if you want, anytime.
You were going to look into the banners off the flamp posts.
Oh, did I? Oh, I was going to do that. I'm sorry.
Yeah, you were.
I forgot about that. I was thinking you were going to do the voting signs. You're right. I'll check in. I can get an answer for you tomorrow.
Okay. You still good with that?
Yeah. So I thought we'd do lawn signs, too.
Yeah, I apologize. That was good. That's,
good. Let's do that.
Okay.
One or the other. Yeah. We'll chip in. We'll all chip in.
We got a fundraise, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Last thing. I think all the KP sports teams are doing great.
I saw that.
All
they're all doing well, yep. Proud of them all. Working hard.
Especially proud of that field hockey team. I just got to say it out loud.
So. That's all right.
6-0-2.
If only they had a coach.
Yeah. It must be the talent of the player. I think it's the talent of the coach and the player.
Your wife does a wonderful.
They were in the Boston Globe, top 20 today.
Your wife does a great job with that team. Yeah. She does a great job.
And they beat Mansfield for the first time in 13 years.
Wow. I think they were all.
Okay. I attended that young team. I attended that neighborhood meeting last night on the 84 Cleveland Street. Ooh. I sat in on that. It was very interesting.
That's a tough That's a tough decision.
It is. I give great credit to the folks that were there. They were very frank and they were respectful, but they were clear on their message, and we'll see what comes of it. I think I think there's an understanding that it's going to happen.
Yeah.
So what can we do to mitigate its impact? And I think towards the end of the meeting, the conversation got sort of framed that way. Is it, you know, what can we do to make it more palatable for the neighborhood? And so hopefully it was constructive. We'll see. The proof will be in what comes out of it. That's it for me.
Okay. Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Well, before we adjourn, all those in favor?
Me too.
All right. I just want to let folks know our next meeting is Tuesday, October 18th. And I want to say it after adjourn, we're done. Thank you, Christine.
Did we get through that?
Yeah.
Early.
Good night, everyone. Thank you.
You're out of practice.